All right, so thank you so much, Clark Blaze, for being on Tales from the South. So this story is set in Fort Lauderdale, Florida. But when your family moved to Fort Lauderdale, you had already lived in East Point, Georgia, in Leesburg, Florida, and in a cabin in the woods without running water or indoor facilities in Lake County, Florida. Is that correct?
That's true. And Gadsden, Alabama, too.
Oh, and Gadsden, Alabama. So what were those years like for you?
We had come down from the north in 1945. My father, being a French Canadian, had always dreamed of warmth. of Florida, basically. We got to Atlanta, where he opened up a furniture showroom, which failed. He had to go then on the road and sell furniture. He had a route from Shreveport to Richmond. It was a huge southern route. And he settled us, for some reason, in Leesburg, Florida, which is a pleasant, strange little town. In Lake County, but Lake County in the 1940s was as bad a place as you could possibly be. It was run by a corrupt, rather vicious, and certainly racist sheriff named Willis McCall, who still feared 50 years after his death. But my father started a little factory, a furniture factory, in a conning tower of an emergency airfield that had been built in the swamps in central Florida, in Lake County. And strangely enough, it started to succeed, enough so that Willis McCall sent his boys over to beat up my father and take back the factory. So we were effectively forced out. And then my father went back on the road and had a huge automobile accident, which laid him up for a year. And that's when we had to move from the town of Leesburg, where we had three rooms in a house, to this cabin in the woods. It was $10 a month rent. And my only companions were moss pickers. And there were 14 of them living in one room. It was Faulknerian. It was really unchanged from the Civil War. I mean, it was, of course, the segregated South. It was impoverished. And the only redeeming quality that I think I got from it was nature. Because you were cheek by jowl with every violence that nature can throw at you, from worms in your feet, to parasites of all sorts, to hurricanes, and to illnesses that just hit all the time. And, you realize that of the 14 kids that I knew from that family, I think 10 of them died during the 2 years that I knew them.
Oh, my goodness.
It was that kind of poverty and that kind of lack of any kind of help. I went to a migrant workers' school, which met twice a week, and the kids were, I was 7 and 8, the kids, and most of them were 18 and 19 kids, and I was still the only one who could read. it was the kind of thing, though, that got me, when I was at Denison and I started wanting to write, I said, well, what am I? What do I have that people would be interested in? What suspense can I gather? And I said, I had these 5 magical years in the Deep South that my Denison suburbanite Clevelanders never knew about. and they didn't associate me with it either. And so I started out turning stories out that were, I said at one time, so swampy they should have been drained, and sprayed after that. So the first 10 stories that I published were all of these southern stories from Lake County, which were really densely southern, Faulknerian, as I said. This story that I read today was written about 40 years ago in Montreal when I was beginning to put together a larger franchise, if I may say, for myself. That is, that yes, I still held on to the South, but this was the urban South. Mm-hmm. This was a middle-class South. And this was a Canadianized South, the French and English Canadianized South. And those were all things that were, I realized that I had to integrate because my my southernness was not bogus, but my southernness was not sustainable over a long period. I didn't know the South after 1950. Mm-hmm. Things I understand have changed.
Just a little bit, yeah. Yes. And so around the fifth grade, your father moved your family and you, now a southern boy, to Winnipeg, Canada.
Right.
So was that culture shock
for you? Well, I went from 95 degrees to about 50 degrees below zero overnight. My grandparents, we were living in my grandparents' house and my cousins and all, and I had to quickly develop another, you know, personality to deal with it. My cousins would get me to want to talk, and they'd say, "How now, brown cow?" and then I'd say, "How no, brown cow?" to sort of mock them and their Scottishness. But it was a tough thing because American school kids who ended up in Canadian schools were automatically dropped two grades. Hmm. But coming from my migrant school in Florida, I could have been dropped four grades. And my aunt, who was a very influential person in Winnipeg, said, "You will not do that." Canada being a little bit more authoritarian in its structures, she simply went to the school board and said, "That's not going to happen with my nephew." Mm-hmm. And so I had to, in Canadian schools, by the fifth grade, you were doing algebra, trigonometry, French, Latin. You were doing all these things that were far from the Florida curriculum.
You wrote that your Southern career was not long, but it cut deep.
Yes.
And so I know you wrote the Southern stories. How else? Can you elaborate on that for us?
Well, as I said, I wanted to have hold of something that I knew was authentic. I mean, that I could vouch for it really happened, and the only thing that I had that had been given to me in that author's sense was the Deep South, mm-hmm. were those years in Leesburg and Tavares and in the lake country, in the swamp country, and I exploited it, I guess, ruthlessly until I had no more to say, and then that was scary. But then, by that time, I had started to see that I wasn't just a Southerner. I was never really just a Southerner, but I was a Southerner with Yankee background. And it wasn't Yankee, it was Canadian. And it wasn't just Canadian, it was French and English Canadian. And so trying to bring, as I tried to do in this story, to try to bring all those things together was my new calling, you could say.
And so in the story that you read tonight, The Bridge, you had this near-death experience in the Atlantic. Mm-hmm. And then you also left the municipal pool without learning to swim. So did you ever learn to swim?
Yes.
Okay, good.
Not proficiently, but enough to paddle around lakes and end up with a body full of leeches. That was in Canada. Yeah. So that's another story.
Well, good. We have a few minutes left tonight for audience questions. You can ask Clark anything that you'd like. And if you have a question for him, you can raise your hand and I will bring the mic around. And give me a second to get there. It reaches pretty far, so. All right.
I'd like to know a little bit more about your time in Gadsden, Alabama.
It was like all of my times in those years. It was short because my father couldn't keep a job. My father was a violent man. He had been an underworld guy in Montreal. He had been a rum runner out of Montreal during Prohibition, and he was a tough guy, and he was illiterate. So you put all that together in the furniture business, which has a Yiddish word. It's called borax. Meaning that it's dog eat dog, salesman pitched against salesman for the commission. And so if you worked on something and some other salesman writes it up, he gets the commission, even if he didn't do anything. And that was open warfare for my father, because he only thing he had was his fists. And so in Gadsden, That was another, well, yeah, I hate to speak ill of the dead, but, I love my father in many, many, many complicated ways, but he was a womanizer. He was a classic traveling salesman. And there was a woman in Gadsden, and my mother probably suspected that there was, but always went along with whatever he wanted. So we moved to Gadsden so he could be closer to her. But that didn't last very long because he got into a fight. Gadsden reminded me a lot of the South Georgia cities, like Valdosta and Americus and Tifton, those kinds of, if you know those towns, yeah. A big, wide main street, and then drifting off into disreputable side streets. Various southern franchises, Western Auto, all those kinds of stores. Thanks for bringing up Gadsden. It's never been in the forefront of my ever.
At what point do you think you began to turn the corner and began to think that you might possibly have a brain in there and could hold your own with the Canadian kids?
That's also a very good question. I think it had to do... Boy, I'm revealing too much. I was assigned a sixth grade girl to be my tutor. And I immediately, of course, fell for her. Her name was Valerie Kenny, and she was from the Kenny family. I don't know if you remember, but some of you may know Sister Kenny, the polio, the Australian nurse who did the blanket treatment for, well, she was the niece of Sister Kenny, an Australian-Canadian girl, and very, very bright, and took me under her wing. And she saw in me that I wasn't a stupid Yank, as my cousins reminded me often, and so there was a kind of Tom Sawyer, Thatcher quality to it, that it was not even puppy love, it was pre-puppy love. But that was one person I owe a lot to, and of course to my aunt and uncle who were, always there for me, and telling me I was okay. And I had a very bright cousin, 2 or 3 years older than me, who was setting records everywhere, and she came around to my side, and there were things like that. They were useful. I had a very good teacher, and teachers are everything, if I may say so. She would stay after school for me, hours. If it took hours to drum trigonometry into my head, she would do it. So that was Miss Corbett, Scottish, thick accent off the boat. It was just a very, the Canadian world was, I was coming into it. It was my parents' world, but I was coming into it from very different, distant shore, from Florida. And it was so strikingly different to me. We'd think of Canada and U.S. being very, very similar, but boy, it wasn't. Not for me in 1950 when I settled there. It was, it was something that made me feel at home because these were confident, educated people, progressive mentalities, political animals, and I had been living among sharecroppers and moss pickers, and I had seen the worst. I'd seen the worst of the old South. So I felt I connected there more. I don't mean to insult, you know, the South, but it, you know, there are histories. There is a history, yeah. And Canada is not perfect either. So.
You stated that you had spent a bit of time in your childhood in the South. Mm-hmm. I'm just curious whether you subsequently, have you spent any extended period of time in the South, and if not, why not?
When I was at Denison, I quit. My parents divorced, and I was at loose ends, and I was a science major. And so I went back to Florida, got a job as a busboy at a resort hotel in Fort Lauderdale. That lasted about 3 weeks. And a friend of mine said that he was on exchange at Fisk University in Nashville. And he said, would I come up to Nashville and do sit-ins with him in the bus stations and Woolworths and things like that? So I said, yeah. So I did. Ended up in jail, but with a good man. I learned on two nights in jail, I learned more than I probably had in all my life. The jails, of course, were segregated. Now that's one of the ironies. But we were close enough to where we could hear their talking and they could hear our talking. And I was in the cell with a man who had been a theology student at Vanderbilt and had been, of course, immediately expelled when he was arrested. And his parents' store had been burned the very night, burned down in Mississippi, where he was from, on the very night that his arrest was announced. But he sat there all night long reading aloud to everybody in the whole jail wing the letters of Vincent van Gogh to his brother, and letters, Dear Theo, I don't know if you know the letters that van Gogh had written. And it was a transforming experience to me. I, as I said, I'd been a science student, I had a science major, geology major, and I immediately knew that I wanted to write letters like Vincent van Gogh, or I wanted to, I wanted to stay intact. But and it was something very moving to me, and a major change in my life. I came back to Denison as an English major, and started writing those swampy Southern stories.
So, is this your first time to Little Rock?
I've been through Little Rock many times. It's the first time I've really stopped. I've been in Conway, mm-hmm. The first time. So, Arkansas has not been a major zone, but I did live. One of our many short stops in Springfield, Missouri, and we used to come down every weekend to Lake of the Ozarks and things like that. So Arkansas is not unknown to me, but it's not been a central stopping.
All right, so thank you so much, Clark Blaze, for being on Tales from the South.